almost,
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 major,
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 major. Holy fucking shit, this is major.
Hello and welcome to this week's episode of Almost Major, where we talk about the many major studios and the films they released. We are on our 1980s New Line miniseries. My name is Kevin Tudor. I'm here with Brighton Doyle.
Hello.
And Charlie Nash.
Hello.
And joining us again is Michelle O'Connell. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
And today we are talking about Tougher Than Leather, also from 1988. This was released on September 16th, 1988, in 130 theaters. The budget for this is, quote, under $300,000. this is the only, I'll get into it with the trivia as far as, like, where did that come from. Opening weekend made $748,000 and a domestic and overall gross of $3.5 million. Top five films that weekend is Fish Called Wanda, Die Hard, Moon Over Peridor, which I had never heard of. I believe that is a...
Is it Paul Mazursky?
Yes, yes. Much more well-known movie, which we'll be covering, Nightmare on Elm Street 4, The Dream Master, and Who Framed Roger Rabbit. That's a hell of a five.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's quite eclectic.
Yeah.
I also wouldn't have guessed Fish Called Wanda would be at the top of those, but I guess it depends on how far into the releases all of these are.
Yeah, I'm guessing that's a few weeks into the Who Framed Roger Rabbit run. I doubt Moon Over Peridor was just absolutely blowing it off the screen.
Yeah. the infamous flop Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Yeah.
Number one song in the U.S. this week is, funnily enough, Sweet Child of Mine by Guns N' Roses.
Very good song.
And number one song in Canada this week, I've never heard of this, Monkey by George Michael. Plot description from Google: three ripped off rappers, played by Run-DMC, come down hard on money laundering thugs behind Strut Productions. Okay. Written by Rick Manello and Rick Rubin, with story by credits by Bill Adler and Lior Cohen. Manello co-wrote Two Lovers in 2008 and The Immigrant in 2013. You just fell upwards in this industry.
Dare I say?
Better movies?
Yes.
That's what you're trying to say? Bold take, bold take. Directed by Rick Rubin, this is his only directed film. He is primarily a music producer and a co-founder of Def Jam Records. Starring Run-DMC, the Beastie Boys, both of them previously in Crush Groove 1986. That's a fun movie. And also my man Richard Edson is here. Trivia. Spike Lee was the first person offered to direct the film after Russell Simmons saw School Days. Lee politely turned it down and wrote and directed Do the Right Thing instead. Do you think he made the right call?
I don't know that the timing for that works out. I call BS on that.
Call BS? You're calling BS on a unfounded IMDb trivia fact, really?
Okay. I feel like Tougher and Leather than School Days are too close together in release for that to have been accurate.
Mm. Yeah,
it's also funny to think Spike Lee politely turned this down. Just like, oh, fuck
the script,
no.
Is not my cup of tea.
Yeah. Love Spike Lee so much. It's just funny that they use the word politely, like, before that, like, as if, yeah, he had like a martini in his hand or something.
I don't believe I'll do that, because he tried to get work on Crush Groove and they didn't hire him, but Ernest Dickerson shot Crush Groove.
Yeah.
And it looks great.
So, yeah.
Ernest Dickerson did not shoot this movie, I don't think.
No,
not this one.
No. No.
Also, another unfounded, I searched this and the only place I found it was on IMDb, was this film was shot in late 1986 for a small budget of under $300,000. Then producers raised some more money, a few hundred thousand more, to put it in post-production, thus the delay in the release. Don't know where that came from, could not find it anywhere else talking about that, so who knows. But this I did find is Rick Rubin said of his experience on this movie in 2005 is very unpleasant. I like rock and roll hours much better than movie hours. In those days, I was sleeping until 2 or 3 in the afternoon, and having to wake up at 6 a.m. and go to work every day was a disaster. We were just in completely over our heads. We didn't know what we were doing, just having fun and doing crazy stuff. I like the fact that we did it because we did it.
Mary, Mary, why are you bugging?
The rhythm. Payoff. The setup. The showdown.
Run-DMC!
The heat.
Who killed Ray?
I don't know.
The chase. The danger.
I don't know about this, Vic.
The action.
Run-DMC!
The power.
Well, here you go.
The violence. The girl.
Mary, I need your hugging.
There's a quarter of $1 million in small bills inside.
It's empty, just like your future.
Everybody cracks in them. How about smack?
Be quiet and don't think.
Run, DMC. The hit. The top gun. The bottom line.
I don't like this, man.
This time, somebody else is going to be dancing to the music. Run DMC is tougher than leather for New Line Cinema.
Initial thoughts. I'll go first. I think I'm somehow the most positive one of this, even though I did give it 2.5 stars. I think going into this thinking it was going to be like utter dog shit and then being like pleasantly surprised it had like some sort of personality is probably what gave it off to me. But also, it's Run DMC and Beastie Boys. I'm going to have fun just watching them interact. But yeah, I mean, there's the hip-hop movies that I watched prior, some of them being like great documentary like Style Wars, or a movie that's like not that good acting wise but it's just a very important movie like Wild Style, or something like Breakin', which is just like, yeah, we have no plot, but you came to watch people dance, so that's what's gonna happen. Like, this one actually does have a plot. There's just some action scenes. Maybe I'm giving it way too much credit, but I don't know. And they're also like not that terrible of an actors as I thought. I thought they would be a lot worse. I just think they're really fucking cool, and that translates in the movie, so. But yeah, I was expecting this to be, like, truly dire. It never made it past VHS, and honestly, it's not that bad. Most 80s hip-hop movies are set around, like, 2 or 3 rappers doing their songs, and then you went to the theater just to see them perform it. Crush Groove kind of falls into that, but the problem is the song's kind of kick-ass. Now, the Rick Rubin, like, bad business guy stuff is just, like, top-tier, low-tier shit, but like I said, it was just Run DMC on screens. Now I'm digging that part. And some could say the score is overplayed and they would be right, but also after like the 30th time it gets needle dropped, I was just like, you know what? This is kind of cool.
I'm sorry, I'm just chuckling because Bryden initially twitched when you said it's not that bad, and now it's like he's trying to physically restrain himself from saying
can
something.
I get through this? Can I get through this?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
So I will say it was very funny at the start. It starts with like Flavor Flav talking and whatnot, and I thought it was like the start of like a Public Enemy song that I never heard of. But you're supposed to insinuate that Flavor Flav is in the jail with DMC as well. I thought it was very funny. They performed Beats of the Rhyme. They call it DMC, Mary Mary, and Run's House. I mean, I can't help but give it 2.5 stars. So that alone, I'm sorry, but Bryden, we gonna go score corner first or what?
Yet the score is very basic and repetitive, and it's used like very badly, I think, throughout the movie, because it will just like it will come in like through the scenes like to sort of like, I guess, set up tension or anything, but it'll just like drop out at like very arbitrary moments, so it doesn't really even feel like it's really adding a whole lot of atmosphere to the scene. It just feels like it's like you could have just like not had this in the movie, and it like it, and I feel like that's just like kind of a lousy score. I do think the music is, like, the musical performance scenes are, they're reasonably well filmed. They're not like quite as well done as like, you know, Crush Groove and everything, where like the lighting is like really expressive and everything, you know, like in Crush Groove when they do, I think they perform Run's House in that, but when like it's like just after Run DMC has had an argument with that movie's Russell Simmons standing, played by Blair Underwood, and he's like, whose motherfucking house is this? And it's like got this like red lighting that like adds to sort of like the anger that the performer is feeling or anything, like that's like really good. You don't get anything quite like that in this movie, but the performance, like, it is kind of baffling, the gulf in quality between like the performance, the charisma that Run DMC has like as stage performers, and when they're performing the music and everything, like the way that like they're like jumping into the frame with each other to like, you know, sort of like bounce off of each other with their lyrics and everything, and like they really seem comfortable on stage and everything, and then like the moment that they have to do anything involving like the narrative or playing characters, it just like, it's such a steep drop off in quality. I think it's Joseph Simmons. I mean, like, I think he's the, in Crush Groove, I think he, in both this and Crush Groove, he's like the one where it's like, oh, there's like a little bit of screen presence. Like, he's adequate and everything. I think it helps in Crush Groove that he's like bouncing off of Sheila E., who he has like really good chemistry with. And she's like wonderful in that. I really liked her as a performer, and also just like watching her like just like hang out with people and that. But like, and in that, in Crush Groove, it's very noticeable that like the other two members of the group, like they are like just like either standing in the background or they have like very little dialogue. And then in this, like when they have like more than like two lines to say, it is just like, I mean, it's like, you, I knew I was kind of in trouble, like when like they have that long scene driving back from prison or anything, where it's like the one member like talking about like the dream where it's it's like he dreams about like getting his dick bitten off, and it's just like, this is like one, this is like the level of humor that we're getting in the movie and everything, but also just like, like the long pauses that are just like coming in between like the conversations. I'm just like, oh fuck, like this is so brutal. And like it, I feel bad citing this because I'm not like as well versed in this show as many people are, but like, you know, I've seen the clip on Always Sunny in Philadelphia where those characters try to start a podcast, but they just like, they're like, they're
dead air.
Yeah. Like, I thought about that a lot during this movie, because there is just like scenes where I'm like, that you could just like cut this down, like, and like, because like I said, like, we're in trouble, like, I think performance-wise, like, it seems that way when, like, you get that car scene. But also, like, just rhythm-wise, like, with the editing, like, there's, like, just the shots of, like, you know, just, where, like, you know, it's a character being, like, let out of prison, and, like, it's just, like, a long shot of, like, them just going down the hallway, and I'm, like, why do we need to see it for like go down like the entire hallway and turn the corner? It's so unnecessary. And yeah, it's the plot, I think, is like, you know, very boilerplate, and it doesn't really seem to have a whole lot of momentum to it. I think that's like, you know, that's in the editing, and it's all resolved in like a way that just seems like a total shrug and everything. Like, you know, they like have like the last confrontation with the character Arthur, who's played by Rick Minello and everything, and and then the movie just like, well, the fade to black edits too, which like, you know, just like feel like, you know, it's like, it feels like we're cutting to commercial like every time that happens or anything, and it's just like, it doesn't have like the right sharpness. I wish we'd had fewer of those sort of bland edits and more of like that. I mean, it's cheesy when it happens, but there's the point where like they I think like one of the characters like punches the camera, and then like it freezes and the glass shatters, and like
kicked ass.
And I'm like, okay, that's really goofy, but like I would, it's at least like an attempt to like bring some style to this movie. Whereas like I find the rest of this movie like is so aggressively understylized and like low energy, and it just like it really just like, I found it like kind of a chore to sit through. It only lit up for me during like the performance scenes where like, yeah, like I. Like, not only is like they're like, are the songs really good, but also like you get like a real sense of like comfort and ease, like in how the performers interact with each other on stage. But yeah, no, I'm sorry, I wasn't wild about this one, but you know, it is an interesting artifact, just as like a weird like curio of like, this was like, this is a movie that exists. And and we talked too about like With Michelle, you mentioned with like the first decline of Western civilization, how like that's like interesting, like capturing sort of like a transitional period between like, you know, with like Black Flag and everything, like it's like where they're just about to get the singer that they're best, one of the singers they're best known for. It's like interesting watching Beastie Boys in this. I know they're minor characters in this, and it's like, but they're just like, this is I think like the year before Paul's Boutique and everything, so they're still on their License to Ill era, where like they're like pouring beer on each other's heads and like being super like douchey to like to people, and like, you know, acting just like, you know, overgrown teenagers and everything. It's like, I'm not saying that like necessarily they still like occasionally had like goofiness in like their subsequent music and everything, but it's like just interesting seeing like, oh, they're just about to outgrow this phase and everything and become more interesting. It's just, I don't know, I thought that was funny, but I don't really think there's a whole lot here, but the music is really good. I've been building the New Line Cinema playlist of songs that are featured in the movies we've covered, and I've added quite a few of the songs featured in this movie to that list, so that's nice.
Yeah, I will say The Tougher Than Leather is probably personally like my favorite album for them, so them to have a full movie for it that just truly doesn't exist. And what was it, the other night I was going to watch Crush Groove on Peacock, where you go to watch all fine films, and I saw an advertisement that there was a Run DMC miniseries that premiered like 3 days ago, and I was like, okay, I'm watching this, and it was 2.5 hours long, not one mention of this movie. Zero mention. So is it bad enough for them to just completely act like this movie doesn't exist? That's what the question that I have to ask.
I think nobody saw it and they just decided to forget about it.
Yeah,
basically. Michelle, go ahead.
I think I'm more with Bryden on this one. I think amateurish is kind of what came to mind when I was watching it. Not really the finest moment for anyone involved. There's a lot of overlap with Crush Groove, except there's a lot that's missing. It's leaning a lot more on Run DMC's acting skills, which are not strong, really. There are several points where it feels like, if nothing else, like putting Rick Rubin behind the camera is a very bad idea, because there are several takes where I'm looking at it and just thinking, that's a bad take. You need to go back and do it again.
Yeah.
Like there's a moment where after a murder takes place, Run walks in, and based on how he walks in, he would have seen someone who is close to him having been killed. Like he would have seen their body first. And instead he walks in, sees someone on the further end of the room who's dead, and then sees the person who he's close with. And yeah, it's bad. Yeah, like the use of color, the use of just actual filmmaking skills that Michael Schultz had, it's just not here. On top of getting Rick Rubin behind the camera with doing something that he's not good at and he can't really keep a pace,
you're saying he's a good actor though.
Yeah, you're putting him in front of the camera where he's also not a good actor, and he's playing a really racist character and shouting a bunch of racial epithets badly. Like it's a very weird thing where he seems self-conscious about how he's saying it, and like it only makes me feel ickier about his use of the word, because he's written this role mm-hmm. for, he wrote it, right? Or co-wrote it?
Him and Benello.
Yeah.
Right. Because, yeah. So he wrote this and directed it for himself to say these lines, to play a sort of stock villain character. And the entire time, it just kind of feels half-assed and like it's downplaying all these things. I don't know. That, and there's no Sheila E., there's no real filmmaking skill that I saw outside of that one weird transition.
That I like leapt out of my chair. That shit kicked ass. Yeah, but I was like, wow, that came out of nowhere.
And the musical performances, it's really great. This is really, I think the reason why I didn't end up hating it, I thought it was bad, but I thought it was an interesting time capsule, is that it is capturing them sort of as they're on top of the world, but right as things are about to come down. Tougher Than Leather is a point where their albums stopped selling quite as much. It didn't make as much as Raising Hell, and it came out, if I remember correctly, there was something of a delay between like Raising Hell and Tougher Than Leather, where the album was supposed to come out earlier than it did, and by the time it did come out, the Run DMC's moment had kind of, if not passed, like they really were on a come down, and like bands like Public Enemy and NWA were on the come up. And it's just a very interesting time capsule for a band that is for a very, very short amount of time still the biggest rap group in the world. An appropriate companion piece with Decline of Western Civilization in that sense, even if it's a much worse movie with much better music.
Yeah, and also I think, if I may, Charlie, I want to hear your thoughts in a moment, but it's also an interesting comparison in that Decline of Western Civilization, the metal part two, the metal years, there's a lot of, you hear the subjects saying a lot of really misogynistic and sexist things, and I feel like that movie is like subtly critiquing it, whereas here I feel like a lot of it goes unchecked, like a lot of misogyny. It's just like the movie's like, it's like the bad characters who are saying stuff like this, like, but like it's also like the movie seems to be sort of like smirking like yeah, but that's also true, right? And it's like it's like really gross.
Yeah, well I feel like part of that is that there's really no distance between the people making the music and the actual filmmakers in this case, because Penelope Spheeris is not actually part of the hair metal scene, where most of them probably aren't going to undercut subtly what they're saying if they're directing the movie.
Yeah.
If Paul Stanley is directing The Decline of Western Civilization.
Oh my
God, I think I just envisioned the worst movie ever made.
But yeah, you are right. I believe it was in between Raising Hell and Tougher Than Leather. I think it may have been right before Tougher Than Leather. They actually went on tour with NWA, and NWA started almost a riot before they even got on stage, and people were just, and they had to be this isn't us, we're not these type of people, but it's already changed to, that's the group that people want to see. So once the Tougher Leather's the last gasp, because then 2 years later they're doing a new Jack Swing album and people are just what the fuck is this?
Yeah, and complete with the sound, their specific emphasis on a combination of rock with rap just kind of fell by the wayside compared with the heavy sampling.
Yeah, because everything after this album is definitely trying to catch a trend, and then before that they were the trendsetters, which, as bad as we all think this movie is, first four Run DMC albums should be up there with the first four Led Zeppelin albums. Not as good particularly, but as far as impact, they should be known as that fucking great, because wow,
they're really good.
Yeah, Charlie, you're biting at the bits to talk about this movie.
I have nothing to add that has not been said already.
All right,
I really don't. Everything Michelle and Bryden have said is pretty much how I feel exactly, and I am no expert when it comes to Run DMC or even 80s hip hop in general. I just thought that, the musical performances are great, and then the lack of energy, the contrast in between the performance scenes and then just this, it's a curio, but it's also barely a movie at the same time, and it's just a typical revenge plot. Better music than Decline of Western Civilization Part 2, but in terms of filmmaking craft and aestheticism, this is just, it's just sort of there. There's no style, there's no, I really don't have anything new to say that hasn't been said already, so I'm sorry, guys.
So what you're saying is Rick Rubin is not a one-hit wonder as far as directing films go. Not like Hype Williams or...
Oh my God, Belly is just unbelievable. And this is...
I mentioned in our group chat, it's funny that we've done, so far in our entire show's run, we've done, three sort of hip-hop, sort of genre movies with Hype Williams, Belly. I don't remember who did State Property. I feel really bad.
I don't remember. I blocked State Property from my brain.
State Property and then this. And it's Belly is clearly the number one. This is, I think, number two, because at least it has some decent music performances.
State Property, top three worst movies.
State Property is dog shit narrative, easily. But also there's no good music in it either. It's not even fun to listen to. It's just
No. I'll confess, I don't think I've listened to the State Property episode.
Oh, it's
it's totally fine.
You missed three people just being what do we talk about? Please, something.
One other connection between Tougher Than Leather and Decline of Western Civilization 2. Two artists who work together, Run DMC and Aerosmith.
There you go. Yeah, actually, yes. Thank you for mentioning that, because in our group chat, we were also talking about how the Guitar Hero Aerosmith video game that came out in the late 2000s and how you could play awesome. as Run DMC in that game, right, Kevin?
Yeah, you get to do a King Rock and Walk This Way. Funnily enough, I can't think of the title right off the top of my head, but I've listened to a whole book just about the creation of Walk This Way, which is, just fascinating that happened. Also, it needs to be said that it's just Aerosmith, Run DMC basically brought Aerosmith back with that song. It was not Aerosmith being oh, come here, guys. It was more so just they were just why are we doing a song with washed out rock musicians? And then that song became the biggest thing, and it also became their downfall, because it never got bigger than that, unfortunately.
Yeah, and in the meantime, it brought Aerosmith back from being a pretty good rock group in the 70s to one of the worst bands of all time.
Oh, you're not a big Get a Grip Aerosmith album fan? No?
No.
Not a big Pink or what about...
Do not care if a dude looks like a lady. Do not care for Ragdoll. Don't care for any of that shit.
What about... What was that one they had in the... No. What about Jaded?
No.
that one they had in the aughts. That and... wasn't Mila Kunis in that video?
I don't know.
Okay, we got to run it down. We got Crying. That's got Alicia Silverstone, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. What about, what is it? Janie's Got a Gun.
Janie's Got a Gun was directed by David Fincher.
Goddamn right.
Oh, God. What was that? It was a real slog 2000 song. What was it? Fly Away From Here or whatever. Remember when that was on, like, the radio and in CBS is everywhere for, like...
They had a cover where it was like a robot woman on the cover. I remember
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it was doing the Marilyn Monroe
Why
pose.
Do I remember That's the hilarious. Name of yes. that goddamn album?
Yeah.
yeah, pretty much. I mean, their last song is Don't Want to Miss a Thing, and then they never made anything ever again. It's very sad.
Which was my slow song at my high school prom. Jesus Christ.
Well, not at my prom. At a semi-formal, it played as a slow song in like the early 2010s.
I think we had like Flo Rida as our slow song at prom or some shit.
A little out of date, that song, I'd say, for the slow song.
I know. That would be some shit where we'd be like, I'm not slow dancing to this. I don't even remember Armageddon.
So tougher than leather, huh?
It is the kind of movie where, like, even, like, the when it does stumble into, like, a vaguely cool shot, it still, like, is making me, like, think of, like, other things that just piss me off and everything. Like, in the shot where, like, they confront Arthur at the end, the Rick Minnelli character, it's like he's... in the shadowy office, like, you know, like with a briefcase of money and everything, and like the shadows of Run DMC, all three members like appear on the wall and everything, and it's like, oh, that's kind of like a cool, like, sort of moody shot and everything. But then like Rick Minnelli plays the rest of the scene where he's like clearly like Run DMC is coming from like behind him, like off screen, but he's just like turned like as if he's just talking to the shadows, and I'm just like, why would he play this scene that way? It just feels like it's like nonsensical. And then like they're saying like, all right, well, you're gonna tell the police everything, and it's like, but they're gonna kill me if I do this. It's like, well, if you don't tell the police, we'll kill you. And it's like, okay. And then it fades to black, and then there's a performance scene, and the movie's over. And it's just like, what the fuck was even the point of this movie? It's like just such a shrug. That's like, again, like the low energy pacing of the movie. It's just
so much of it feels like a shrug. There's an entire subplot involving a cousin who's good at fixing cars, who then exits the movie abruptly,
and his aunt who doesn't leave the couch, she's in the same position, and then like after the funeral, she's just in a different outfit, and it's like. And she's also, yeah, you were talking about bad takes. She's just like, who could do something like this to my boy or something? It's just so bad.
Yeah. And it's just like one of those. Yeah. It, even when like there's like good actors who I know like have been good at other stuff, like Richard Edson, like you said, like I think he can be like a very entertaining actor. Like I love him in Stranger Than Paradise. But like here, it's just like he's a little more like cranked up in this performance because he just knows he's got like nothing to work with and everything. He's just like,
yeah, and I'm also like, oh yeah. Richard, it doesn't deserve all this. Like, come on, man.
Also, the violence doesn't have any impact. No. That scene where the guy gets shot in the mouth and it's just the like really cheap looking blood spatter that just looks terrible.
The cutting in that scene is wild too.
It really is.
Like, to make it as extended as possible and also make it as clear as possible that nothing is actually happening.
And then there's also like it, even the scene where the car blows up at the end is like weirdly edited.
Okay, so we're talking about Richard Edson we're talking about Richard Edson in the scene where he and Rick Rubin are negotiating, and one other guy are negotiating with Russell Simmons, real life Russell Simmons, over the over getting Run DMC and the Beastie Boys. Is the camera placed in a really weird place in that scene?
It's in so many scenes where it seems like they're like just right up against the edge of the against the lens and everything. It's just like, mm-hmm. They're way too close. It's so weird. There's so many scenes like that.
Really,
like,
bizarre.
And
they're so close, and it's not made better by the fact that Rick Rubin and Russell Simmons can't fucking act.
And I feel like there's also a few moments too where like people like accidentally like glance into the camera too, and it's just like, again, like the thing is like, you couldn't have like cut a little bit earlier or like gotten a different take. It's just like,
you can see
it does feel a bit like Black Dynamite at some time, in some cases. Like,
you can see Richard Edson looking out of the frame to see if Jim Jarmusch or Spike Lee are there with a script for him.
I thought Spike Lee was directing this and be like, no, Richard, get in there. Yeah,
that's the public enemy, that they're in the Spike Lee movie, the public enemy.
I will say about that is that I assume this was shot like in widescreen and we're only seeing this in 1.33 because it's a VHS, so there's that. But I mean, that's not to say that there's not camera angles that are wonky in this regardless.
Yeah, I will say, it's, you know, you're dealing with something bad when the scene where it's the scene where like Run DMC reunite outside the prison and it's shot like a fucking like Western standoff or anything with like all the wind blowing in the background, all the close-ups and everything. That shot, their reunion is shot with more tension than like the actual like standoff with guns and people getting killed in the warehouse at the end. Like, it's just like people are like, I don't know, just walk down a long hallway and then they get shot. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. This can't be our shortest episode. Come on now.
All right, which hair metal band do you want Run DMC to collaborate with?
Warrant.
Warrant actually have quite a sad story behind them.
Oh, jeez. Well.
Oh, should I? I don't actually want to get into it.
Okay.
I watched this movie when I was sick. I took a day off from work because I was sick, and I watched it, and it's kind of gone as a result. I'm sorry.
And did you watch it too? Like after, this is the thing that like I've gotten like pretty good about this. Like when we're doing double features on the show, it's like I'll say like, all right, I think this movie's probably gonna suck, so I'll watch this first and everything, and then like the one that I know has like a good reputation, I'll watch that later and everything. Whereas you like watch like I'll watch the Decline movies first and everything, and then like it's like when I'm sick, I'll watch Tougher Than Leather. I'm like, okay, like,
yeah, I know.
Well,
I know.
What I did is I did all my hip hop movie research, and then I ended it with Tougher Than Leather, and then the next one was Decline 2, and then I did metal research or Spheres research afterwards. So
I did do my Spheres research after this one, but I think that also only pushed this further out of my brain. Like,
Crush Groove is kind of fun though. Like, Michelle, like you said, like that one, like. Again, like a little bit of a looser narrative, but like also like there is like a little more of a, there's like a lightness to that movie that's like, you know, kind of like endearing and everything. Like, you know, where like he does like have like some sort of a sketch comedy feel sometimes to it. And also like it is like kind of like everyone like just like it's like it does have like kind of a niceness to it, where like it's like, oh yeah, I like you and everything, but you clearly like this, like, you know, Joseph Stern's being like, oh, well, Sheila, I really like you, but, oh, I guess it's okay that you like this guy and everything. I'll be happy for you and everything. And whereas in this, I feel like there's just, like, a nastiness to every interaction in Tougher Than Leather. And it's just like, oh, this is just kind of a bummer.
Yeah, it's just a generally unpleasant movie, but, like, not so much that you're going to feel really strongly about it. It just kind of sits there dead. And
yeah.
You take in the casual sexism of it, the unpleasantness of how Run DMC and the Beastie Boys are being asked to act, and I don't know, just sort of kind of like, I'll bring it back to Decline of Western Civilization too, how like it, all of these people are incredibly young as they're becoming famous, and they haven't necessarily shaken off some of their less evolved attitudes, especially towards women. And it's all up there on the screen in Tougher Than Leather, and would probably be more offensive than it is already, if not for the fact that the movie just feels so tossed off.
Yeah.
What about that scene where they go into the shower and they're just taking the clothes off one by one, and then you hear a gunshot, and then it turns out to be a fake out? Like,
I hate when that happens.
yeah, like it's that type of thing where it's just like, oh, and then it's just like, oh, psych. It's just like,
are you talking about the scene where they seduce Rick Rubin's girlfriend? Is that the scene you're talking
yes,
about?
Yes. Yeah.
That scene has just like such a.
Gross aftertaste.
Yeah, just because it's like it's saying like, well, we'll have sex with you, but also menace you at the same time. Like, you know, have it both ways. And then like there's the scene where like the henchmen like threaten to run a train on her and everything. And then like it's You're just like, oh, jeez, what the fuck, man? Like, I don't like sitting through this. It's, yeah. Oh, I mean, we might as well also shout out some of the other performers in the movie, too. Like, we get the performance from Slick Rick performing, what's the song title
again? It's called Treat Her Like a Prostitute. I really wish they had included a different Slick Rick song in the movie, but it feels appropriate.
And then the other performer was... gosh, it's the performer, I think, like at the backyard party that they go to. Is it the Junkyard Band? I think that's the band that also performs.
Yeah.
And then you hear, like, you know, songs from like Public Enemy and Roy Orbison and Danzig on the soundtrack occasionally.
Danzig drop really made me do a double take. Must have been like right around when their first album dropped. I can imagine Rick Rubin listening to them too. So.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, because that was about the time he signed Slayer. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know. I don't know much about like Rick Rubin beyond being like a Def Jam person, but like I feel like he's like got like somewhat of a divisive reputation. I mean, like I don't know like what anyone's taken.
Past like the 90s, a lot of people say that like he's listed as a producer and all he did was like do nothing whatsoever. Like. For Volume 3 for Slipknot, they were like, he didn't do a fucking thing. He came to the studio once. He was like, yeah, sounds good. We never saw him again. Now he's listed as the producer. Yeah, he's definitely like Jay-Z's 12th album, Magna Carta Holy Grail, where he's in the commercials for that.
You're crazy for this one, Rick.
Yeah, 99 Problems. It's a fantastic beat that Rick Rubin made. That's probably the last like great thing that he did.
That was like way back in the Black Album.
That was 03. Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, for that one, they just have him in the commercials just being barefoot on a couch, just being like, yeah, it sounds good. And I mean, that's him for the past like 20 years, man. I mean, what he did as far as bringing Def Jam, bringing Run DMC, all of that stuff, truly iconic shit. Being the type of guy to be like, I'm a signed Slayer and Beastie Boys and Run DMC, and it doesn't feel weird. Like, he definitely was a visionary in that sense. But I mean, yeah, as the years went by, it was just like, I can just put my name on shit and get paid, right? And people were just like, yeah, I guess, man.
Did anyone else in the scene where the camera is placed weird and they're too close to it as they're negotiating hear the mention of the Beastie Boys as this white rap group and Rick Rubin's reaction of white rap group as he's white, like the Elvis white rap group? I don't know.
White.
That's what I got, folks, about Tougher Than Leather. Not a lot.
Thank you for listening to this week's episode of Almost Major. Please rate, review, and subscribe to us on iTunes. Please follow the pod on Twitter at Almost Major to keep up to date with what movies we will be covering in the future. Myself, I can be found on Twitter and Letterboxd at Kev Bonesy. Bryden can be found on Twitter at Bryden Doyle and on Letterboxd at J Doyle. Charlie can be found on Twitter and Letterboxd at CTNash91. Once again, thank you for listening.